Okay, welcome everybody. Good to see a good audience. My name is Ian Clark and I'm the Dean of the school. So thanks for coming and thank you ahead of for Richard for agreeing to do this inaugural lecture. Welcome to the Business School. I know many of you have been here quite a bit before. We seem to be becoming a venue for the university for inaugural lectures, and Shona was saying to me earlier, we're trying to get a number of our own in here as well. So we hope to see you more in here going forward. So it's a pleasure to introduce Richard, and if you just permit me to do the normal stuff when you're introducing inaugural lectures. Context is important, I think, and that's the new bit I want to add. 2.5 years ago, when I joined Edinburgh and took over as the dean, a key initiative in our strategy was to, put simply, identify areas that would make a difference to us as a school and to business and so on. And we wanted to, and we have in the process of doing, building agendas that confront a number of that are challenges faced by organisations, so themes, if you like. And one of those was and is strategic leadership. And our definition of that, or the colleague's definition of it, goes something along the lines of leadership's important to organisations because it has three key, it's a balancing act of three key things. It's about being strategic, it's about making choices, so it's about strategy, it's about seizing opportunities, which are often the flip side of strategy, and getting a balance between those two: objective identification, opportunity identification, entrepreneurial activities, and the whole process of being strategic, which can lead to quite bureaucratic behaviour, and the sort of soft leadership skills, if you like, that help realise those opportunities. Come in, John. How are you? So that's part of the context. And one of the main things we did initially is we went out and we searched, and we wanted to bring a number of new chairs in, four to be precise, in this space. And we were successful, very successful, in attracting four talented individuals from the UK and overseas, and including Richard. And to the point of ignoring the age-old wisdom of never going back to where you worked before, I'm pleased to say Richard joined us. I'll say a bit more about that in a second, and I'm really pleased that he did. A bit of background, I know many of you know Richard, but some don't. He was born in Belfast, and like many business academics, he's one of those that's got a background, like me, in geography with his first degree and also his PhD from Queen's University, Belfast. Richard was with the school between 2002-2005 and was the Dixon's Chair in Entrepreneurship and Innovation. And he was with us here. Obviously, I wasn't here at the time, but for 4 years. What else can I say? I mean, in terms of background, he's got a number of visiting appointments with Deakin University in Australia, with Chongqing in China, with Lund in Scandinavia. And he rejoined us summer 2013, September 2013, as a chair in strategic leadership, and obviously bringing his expertise in leadership, and particularly in entrepreneurship. Richard, as I'll say in a second, as you will see, brings those two harmoniously and very cleverly together, I think. But at its heart, Richard's interests centre on not just on entrepreneurship, but on how entrepreneurs learn, how they lead, how they need leading, and particularly in terms of one strand of Richard's research on issues to do with entrepreneurial finance. And it's those things that he's bringing and foregrounding within the Leadership Centre's agenda. He's an authority on all sorts of things. All the conversations I have with Richard, I always find something new about him. But he's an authority on business angels, on early stage venture finance, and he advises governments, development bodies, in all sorts of ways, including consulting. He advises too on risk in markets, risk in capital markets, with the UK Business Angels, with HM Treasury, with Link Scotland, Department of Business Innovation and Skills, OECD, EU, the list goes on. And another key feature, and I had the pleasure of travelling with Richard before Christmas for a week or so when we visited China, is Richard's got fantastic knowledge of the country, and he's a central coordinator in an initiative between a number of Chinese and UK universities, the UK-China Entrepreneurship Competition, which is there to promote entrepreneurial behaviour across our students and so on. And we're now one of the key schools within that as a result of Richard joining us here at Edinburgh, so really appreciate that. And he's close to practice and does exec ed, and as you'd expect with somebody with that experience. He's got wider roles. He's the co-editor of Venture Capital, the Journal of Venture Capital. He's had research funded from ESRC, from Department of Business Innovation and Skills, Scottish Enterprise and others. The bit I like about it, because I value it, because it's what I'm doing at the moment, is Richard's been a dean, so he knows the challenges we face. And on a number of occasions, I've talked to him and sought out his advice in different ways. And I always find his advice sage-like, and I like his wily wisdom. He's smiling now, and he's always got that look on his face. But I find it really valuable in all sorts of ways beyond the work that we do as academics. From the way he talks and his great, it comes out of really grounded, rich experiences and imaginative insights, that scholarly dimension that we don't often talk about in academia. He's a fascinating scholar with a strong practical focus, and he's not just worked in Belfast, but he's had a string of appointments in exotic places like Aberdeen and Ulster and China and Argentina and Australia, US and Canada. Outside of work, he's got a bit of a jazz fetish. I'll let him maybe tell you about that. He's a fly fisherman, which I can imagine him doing since I found that out. But he's migrating to warmer waters as he gets older. And finally, just a very minor introduction to his lecture, The Owl of Minerva, Entrepreneurial Leadership and the Critic of Institutions. I don't want to steal his thunder. I was just asking him about how does this hang together, but I thought I wouldn't steal his thunder. The one thing I would say is both the centre and particularly Richard's work is trying to help us to understand, and practitioners to understand, volatile, uncertain, complex, ambiguous environments, commonly known as VUCA environments, and all the challenges that emerge out of that. And Richard's going to draw on all of his research in entrepreneurship and leadership research to look at how we can help practitioners and academics, and particularly within this school, and him through his own contributions, deal with those predicaments, not just the basics that we do as a business school, but also going way beyond that beyond conventional wisdom. So anyway, that's enough from me. Richard, we're all really looking forward to hearing your thoughts, your ideas on this hugely important topic, not just to Scotland, but particularly to Scotland, I think, given the ambitions of the country, but also to the UK, and I think particularly to globally. So over to you. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much, Ian. I always like starting with a round of applause. I mean, it gets the embarrassment out of the way, and waiting for it at the end of the lecture is always rather more difficult. Follow that. Inaugural lectures are peculiar things. One's never quite sure whether to take a mountaineering analogy. It's to recognize the fact that you've got to base camp climbing Everest and you're looking upwards to the summit, or have arrived at the summit and are contemplating abseiling down the other side. I think I'm somewhere betwixt and between in this one. I was at base camp 8-9 years ago when I last did an inaugural at Edinburgh. And I'm still puzzling over the terminology of being inaugurated twice into a position with the same title. But you know, they do say never step into the, you never can step into the same water twice. But anyway, it's a pleasure to be here. Ian, thank you for those kind words. I promise that I'm neither going to talk at length about jazz nor fly fishing, although one or other of those topics may be of much more interest to the audience than what I am going to talk about. But we'll take that as it comes. Really, my starting point is to recognize that we face a number of very significant challenges, and those challenges pose both threats and opportunities for business schools in particular. And I suppose the encapsulation of the challenge, as I said, is in terms of the questions that face us in terms of the human predicament, the challenges of the world around us, environmental concerns, concerns about climate change, concerns about global terrorism, shift in geopolitical alliances, global financial crisis. All of these have some sort of influence, some sort of resonance, some sort of implications for what we do. And really what I want to do this evening is partly to reflect on work that I've done across a number of the domains that Ian has mentioned, work that is going on, work that is planned, but to set it in the context of a reflection on some of these issues. Really, I suppose, starting with, from the perspective of this is the world we live in, what should our reaction to it be? How do we react? How do we behave? How do we be in this world? And what are the implications for what we do and how we do it? In the business school world, we're used and have got increasingly used over the last 10 years to calls for engagement. Engaged scholarship, concerns about the relevance of our research. It's been an abiding theme in the assessment of our research over the last 5 or 7 years nationally in the research excellence framework. What does it mean to be engaged? What are the implications of the nature of the world we live in for the work we do? And that really, I suppose, is the starting point. I grew up in an era where I listened not just to jazz, but to the Detroit sounds of Motown. And you know, in the immortal words of one of the Four Seasons minor hits, I still believe there are more questions than answers. And this lecture is more about shaping and posing the questions than coming up with the answers. 50 years ago, reflecting on the state of philosophy, Karl Popper, the philosopher of science, talked about the increased scholasticism that we see in philosophy. He said specifically, all the great ideas are buried in a flood of words. What I hope to do this evening is to disentangle some of the ideas from that flood of words, leave you with some thoughts, some questions, maybe some pointers towards answers. I do so in the context where research is a driving force for business schools increasingly. But research, writing, the production and dissemination of knowledge is not and never will be the same as reading. Only 32% of social science research papers have ever been cited. 80% of humanities research papers have never been cited. 27% of research papers in the natural sciences have never been cited. I think that's a problem for the research we do. If we can't talk to our own community, if we don't have that conversation, how do we have a conversation with the world at large? So that's part of what shapes where I'm coming from. What is the role of the business school? And that's where I get to Hegel. It seems like a reasonable place to start, mid-19th century German philosophy. What is the Owl of Minerva? Hegel's phrase, as you see, is the Owl of Minerva spreads its wings only with the falling of the dusk. What does he mean by that? And scholars more adept at this than I will tell you that for Hegel, the dusk represented the end of an era. And his argument was that philosophy, our reflection on that era, can only truly deal with the issues of that era as it has come to an end. We need a sense of perspective. We need to be stepping outside of the frame of reference. we cannot fully articulate the ideas, the issues that drive an era until we have reached the end of it. Philosophy for Hegel, in other words, cannot be prescriptive. It's retrospective. It's an account of how we've got to where we are, not a prescription as to how we've got, how we have, or where we should go. The shift in the late 19th century and through the 20th century from philosophy to science is a shift from a retrospective view of the interpretation of history to a prospective view that science as codified, organized knowledge is much more about, in effect, creating the future. It's about predictive efficiency. It's about the effectiveness of our knowledge. And that's a shift in mindset which has influenced a lot of what we do. What I want to do is reflect on some of the implications of that for the business school. What does dusk look like? To take an illustration, and while Ian made reference in his opening remarks to not having gotten insight into what I was talking about, he did actually quote what was on the slide after next. So we'll come to that. This is one representation of the world we live in. It's a world where we're dominated by climate chaos, stock market panics, etc. Fear and fears, individual and collective, combine and reinforce each other, charging through our world, infiltrating it, jolting it, deranging it. This is a world, an era, in terms of prediction and control, which is coming to an end. There are many responses to it. I'll just quote one from the German theologian philosopher Hans Jonas, writing back in the 1980s or late 70s. And for Jonas, the world we live in, the characterization of fear is a heuristic principle. It is constitutive of the world we live in. We can't escape it. To think about the world, we think in terms of fear, the management of fear. It's a new order of being. Fear for Jonas replaces faith, in particular faith in science, once the great hope of Western enlightenment, which now takes on a threatening appearance. Because many of the issues we deal with, climate change, nuclearization, the global instability, the threat of the spread of nuclear weapons, all of those are issues which are fundamentally the products of science. There are two responses, Jonas argues. One is a return to obscurantism, the aversion from the denial of anything associated with ideas of progress, the accumulation of knowledge. The other response is to think that the worst as possible is happening, and we should embrace it, we should respond to it, we should take advantage of it, we should accommodate it, we should adjust to it, we should learn from it. That is a response that in essence transcends knowledge. It's more than knowledge, and one of the things I want to talk about and reflect on in terms of looking at how the business school functions is this is about the development of wisdom. The world we live in is, as Ian said in his introduction, a world characterized by volatile, uncertain, complex, ambiguous problems. It's also characterized by a fifth element of the acronym, which you see in some of the original discussion of VUCA, and that is D for delay. The availability of information outweighs our ability to process it. There is a delay in assimilating and meaning-making around the information available to us, which makes our decision-making processes in an uncertain world increasingly complex, increasingly difficult. By the time we make a decision, in effect, the world has changed, and the world we implement the decisions is very different. So what are the implications of that? What I want to suggest is that this world of VUCA, which has its various drivers and demands and pressures and responses required of us, does require us to look at where we stand on the bridge between knowledge and wisdom. We talk about living in a knowledge economy. As the academy, not just the business school, but the university system as a whole, we're in the business of, quotes unquote, producing knowledge. The problem is we perhaps are producing more knowledge than we need. If nobody's reading it, there is a question about why we're producing and writing it, which I think is fundamentally something we need to take back and challenge ourselves with. But there is also an issue of where we stand on the bridge between knowledge and wisdom. Do we need, should we think more effectively about the role of wisdom? Now, having said what I've said, it could be assumed that I'm talking in terms of everything is bleak. Of course it's not. You know, the world is not falling apart. I'm not retreating to my mud hut in the wilderness and crying woe is me. Although the attractions of that and the association with the opportunities for engaging in additional fly fishing may have their own attractions. As the urban planner and social theorist Manuel Castell said, we really are moving into the world of informed bewilderment. We have the knowledge, but we don't know how to sense make with that knowledge. And for Castells, the 21st century will not be a dark age, but it will not deliver the bounties that most people expect or have been promised. We've witnessed the most astonishing technological revolution in history. The benefits are unequally and unfairly distributed. His view is we're characterized by increased informed bewilderment. What does that mean? That means that we need to put increased attention on the meta skills of learning about learning. We need to learn how to adapt. We need to learn how to learn. We need to learn how to use the knowledge we have. All of these, although Castells doesn't use the term, all of these are a call for the development of wisdom. In so doing, we are essentially crossing the bridge from the known to the unknown. We're moving essentially from what we know in terms of the familiar and the comfortable to what's unknown, what is strange, what makes us uncomfortable. And I think one of my challenges, one of the challenges that my colleagues face, is to create discomfort. We live in a comfortable world, most of us. The sorts of challenges that I've been talking about and that are summarized in the VUCA acronym actually don't affect most of us on a day-to-day basis. You know, we get up, we do our work, we enjoy our leisure, we interact with our families, with colleagues, with others, we go to bed, and we repeat the pattern. And most of this doesn't necessarily influence us on a day-to-day basis. But it does, and of course, because it doesn't influence us, we pay little attention to it. But it does influence the direction of travel of the society we live in. And I think as business school academics, we have a responsibility to engage with these issues, to begin to chart a way of being in the world that addresses these issues, that signals what else is possible. It is, in effect, to occupy a liminal space, a betweenness, where possibilities emerge, where nothing is set in stone, where nothing is codified. So what does it mean, as it were, to live between worlds? Corson's Inlet is one of the most anthologized poems of mid-20th century American poetry. And it seems a reasonable place to start to reflect on these issues. Ammons, when he wrote Corson's Inlet, is reflecting on a walk along the seashore. Something all of us have done, or a walk along a riverbank, and reflecting on that experience and what it means. His emphasis as he writes, and unusually, perhaps, he wrote the poem in one sitting. The crafting, the wordsmithing, the finessing came afterwards, but he sat, came back from a walk, and wrote the poem, and it's one of his long poems. It's 4 or 5 pages long, 120, 130 lines, something like that. So this was an immediate reaction to his experience of a walk by the shore. And what he's doing in this poem, and where he places emphasis, is really on the breaking down of old orders, of established fixed lines, of established patterns. Seeing those old orders being broken and rebroken, formed and reformed in a continuous process. his metaphor of the eddy, in terms of eddies of meaning, is driven by the coalescence of temporary moments, the flow of events, the picking and unpicking of what happens. It's a resisting of definitions, a resisting of codifications. It's a resistance to establishing boundaries of thought. It's a resistance to reductive philosophy. It's a focus on the flux rather than the stasis of what is going on. What he sees, in other words, is the world as a constantly renewing event. It's a work in progress, which we experience by living in it. It is a change from the fixed, the established, the rigid, the patterned, to the fluid. It's a shift from the perpendiculars, the straight lines, blocks, boxes, bounds of thought, into, as he describes it, the hues, shadings, rises, flowing bends and bounds of sight. This is a pattern that I think increasingly as a style of thinking, as a style of thought, has influenced the work that I've been doing over a number of years. So how do we look at the world from this perspective? Do we look at the world, at the events, at the research we do, at the phenomena we study with hard eyes, looking to separate, to analyze, to dissect experience, very much the scientific method? Or do we look with soft eyes, seeing the flux of relationships, the warp and weft of the experience of being in the world? If, as Ammons argues in Corson's Inlet, there are no sharp lines in nature, why should there be sharp lines in our thinking? Whether that's between disciplines, between models, between frameworks of looking in the world, between us as academics and us as practitioners. Where do we draw the lines? Where do we erase the lines? How do we build a new way of being in the world? Corson's Inlet, as a poem, for me is a major statement about reality. It's about thought, it's about perception. And it suggests that we should avoid perceptual and psychological rigidity in exchange for broader, more open, more tolerant ways of being in the world. And I suppose that, and it's taken me a while to come to a realization of it, but that's the starting point for the research that I've been doing over more years than I care to think. So back to liminality, this creative space, this betweenness, a space of possibility, a space where things happen, this period of transition, the suspension of normal limits to thought, the opening of the way to novelty and imagination, to the construction and destruction of forms of meaning. What does that look like in terms of the search for wisdom? And how does that apply to some of the key areas of work that I've been involved in? That's a genuine question. I mean, if you've got the answer to that, I'd be happy to take it in the back of a postage stamp at the end of the lecture. What I would suggest is that our concern to date, predominantly with the creation, dissemination of knowledge, needs to see a shift to a concern with the development and application of wisdom. Now, this isn't new. Concern with wisdom is long-standing. But if you look at the interest in wisdom in the scientific and the research in the academic community, it is kind of like a bimodal distribution over time. Wisdom was seen as one of the ancient arts. You go back and read Aristotle, for example. Aristotle, and to a lesser extent Plato, is essentially a discourse in wisdom. But concern with and discussion of and application of wisdom as a mode of thought became progressively more and more attenuated. And it is only recently that it has come back as a focus of attention. Given the nature of the world we live in, given the nature of the discourse of crisis, the administration of fear, the VUCA relationships and so on, all of these, I think, point to the need to shift from knowledge to wisdom. I think T.S. Eliot put his finger on it in the Four Quartets. Where is the wisdom we have lost in knowledge? And where is the knowledge we have lost in information? But I also think the Navajo make a point about the difference. It's impossible to wake a man who is not asleep, but is only pretending. So how does this relate? But this is not unfamiliar stuff. There is an element of progressiveness in terms of how we think about these things, shifting from information to knowledge to wisdom, almost as a hierarchy, where the shift is focusing from understanding relations to understanding patterns to understanding more fundamental principles. And we can complicate this or extend this framework into a much broader framework of relations. And we see fundamentally that there is a distinction between the left-hand side of this diagram, the gathering process, the learning process, and the right-hand side, the shift from understanding to wisdom. What I like about this representation of the relationship, this unpacking of that simple three-stage hierarchical development movement from information to knowledge to wisdom, is that it emphasizes that wisdom is about doing. It's about action in the world. It's not about quiet, contemplative, detached, disengaged reflection. If we follow the path of wisdom, it drives us to action. It deals with the issue of engagement, of application, of turning research ideas into practice, of doing the sorts of things that Ian alluded to in his introduction that I think characterize a lot of what I've been trying to do over the past few years. So what does that look like? Go back to Aristotle. And we see this coming up now, particularly in the management literature. Some of the key research journals in the field are now starting to look at wisdom as a key area of focus. Aristotle drew a number of distinctions between techne on the one hand and phronesis, or wisdom, on the other. He also has a discourse about episteme as well, which I'm not going to go into in the course of this lecture. For those of you for whom History of Western Philosophy lecture was not what you were expecting. But techne is the realm of technical knowledge. It's the focus on the instrumental self-gain, the making of things, the exercise of technical skill. It's the approach to knowledge that underlies much of what we have done in the last 150 years in the higher education realm. It's a focus on what is explicit, what is separable, what can be made, what can be seen as freestanding. Phronesis, for Aristotle, wisdom, is much more about prudential judgment than it is about technical knowledge. It's about practice as acting. It's about being in the world. It's about self-cultivating form of action. It's about what is tacit and dispositional. It's not about disengagement. It's about asking different questions. Techne, if you like, is the kind of knowledge one has. Phronesis is about the kind of person you are. And that's the difference. To use an analogy that Nanaka and his colleagues in Japan have used, techne, that approach to knowledge, is the knowledge of how to make a car well. It's about effectiveness. And it's about the narrow physical constraints of what is good practice. Phronesis is much more about knowing what a good car is and how to make it. It's about value and values. And that's an important difference. And I think we need to return to a shift which emphasizes more the phronesis than the techne in what we do. This is your pause for thought while I indulge in a glass of this really quite remarkable gin that the university has provided. And as everyone's expectations are disappointed, it's actually vodka. So what does this mean for us as a bridge into the application to some of the research work that I've been doing? In the title, I talked about this as partly a focus on being a critic of institutions. And somebody said, if you use a word in the title or a phrase in the title of a talk, there is an obligation somewhere in the talk to at least address, if in no more than passing, those words. Alfred North Whitehead talked about philosophy as the critic of abstractions. He also said a university should be imaginative or it is nothing. And I'm not sure that we are necessarily as imaginative as we might be, could be, or should be in universities. An imaginative university is truly a thing to behold. Reflecting on Whitehead, the philosopher Max Fish, writing in the middle of the last century, and I do think it's important that every so often I do quote from somebody who was writing after I was born rather than before I was born. Max Fish just about makes the line there. He talked about philosophy as the critic of institutions. He also talked about philosophy as being interdependent with and interweaved with the social sciences. But he made an interesting observation about the nature of the social sciences as they developed that relationship with philosophy. He said, somewhat presciently, that it may turn out in 50 or 75 years that the social sciences have been a mistake. So no pressure then, there for... And in this domain, we would see much of what we do in the business school as sitting within the social science tradition. By mistake, he means it may turn out that their effort to approximate the mind-free, value-free concepts and methods of the natural sciences and their search for generalizations of the natural science kind have been a mistake. Social sciences may then return to the condition of philosophy, each functioning as a critic of institutions from the base of a particular institution or set of institutions. And what I want to argue, and hopefully to demonstrate in the rest of my talk, is that we can apply that perspective of being the critic of institutions as a framework from which to approach the research and practice in which we're engaged. This will be appreciated by certainly two of my colleagues, fellow conspirators in the Center for Strategic Leadership. Yeah, I do understand what an institution is as well. And that is some arrangement of means or conditions for subsequent activity, additional to or, and so it goes on, you can read the definition. An institution is a way of organized being in the world. The challenge is to move beyond comprehension of the institutions, to develop a critique, to challenge, as it were, conventional wisdom. So how does this apply? As a former teacher of mine said, somewhat aspirationally, here comes the good stuff. But this is beginning to see how some of this will apply. And really what I want to do in the course of the 2.5 hours that are left to me. Oh, sorry. I'm just checking my notes. It's only 1.5 hours. What I want to do is to tease out some of these ideas by reflecting on four areas of practice and research that I've been engaged in, to talk at differing lengths of and differing degrees of detail about how some of these ideas have played out and may play out. The first of these is an area that Ian's already alluded to, is work that I've done and have been engaged in over many years in terms of entrepreneurial finance, where I've essentially been working on the development of, the functioning of, and the roles played by actors in the business angel market in particular. And in that regard, it's a delight to see a number of the key people involved in that market and in the development of that market in the Scottish context here this evening. But if you turn the clock back 30 years, some of us will remember that, some of us will have rather more vague recollections, and some of us will not have any recollections of that at all. The market for finance for new and startup companies was essentially provided for by the banks in terms of institution, wasn't it? Well, actually, no. You can go back to the early 1930s in the Macmillan report, you can look at the Bolton report, succession of report after report, official inquiry after official inquiry in the UK, replicated elsewhere, pointed to a consistent, systematic, persistent absence of access to finance, particularly for new and startup companies. At the institutional level, the criticism and the critique was that the banks in particular weren't working. The public markets delivered finance to only a very small percentage of companies who might have an appetite for new finance. But we were looking at an unorganized market. When I began with colleagues looking at this marketplace 30 years ago, the term business angel, while starting to get some traction in the US, was simply unknown in the lexicon of business language in the UK. When it started to appear in the press, in, for example, the august pages of the Financial Times, it appeared in quote marks. And it was 10 or 15 years before the term stopped being used in quote marks and was accepted as part of the terminology of the language. Yet today we're talking about a market that is estimated to be represent the mobilization of maybe 750 million a year into startup and early stage ventures. Much of that organized through investment syndicates and organized groups, such as Archangel. Much of that still represented by the informal connections between individuals. How did that happen? It didn't happen entirely, much as I have a very strong self-efficacy bias, it didn't happen just because some of us started to research this, although I think that was part of it. It happened in spite of much of what we took for granted as conventional academic knowledge. I can remember 30 years ago having a conversation with a colleague who had just been appointed and just joined us in an institution other than this one as a professor of corporate finance. And I'd begun to get interested with others in this phenomenon of business angel investing, and I thought, well, somebody who's interested in corporate finance and has risen to the dizzy heights of the professoriate. And at the time, I was a humble research assistant doing the lowest of the low in academic terms, except for doctoral students, of course. And I thought, I'll ask this wise and eminent person, who's even wiser and even more eminent now than he was 30 years ago. And I said, I'm interested in this phenomenon of business angel investing. And I described the phenomenon. I said, what theoretical apparatus coming from your knowledge of corporate finance should I use to explain and account for what's going on? And he looked at me, as only a corporate finance professor can, and said, I don't think I can be any help to you because the phenomenon you describe cannot exist. And I said, what do I do with 127 interviews with people doing this, talking about the 350 investments they've made? Sometimes the institutions we need to criticize are the institutions we work in, not the institutions we study. So we've got a market that developed, essentially it was an unknown market. We had much of conventional practice and conventional wisdom in academia and academic research predicated on the assumption that this type of market, this type of activity did not and could not exist. It did exist, it developed enormously as we began to throw light on the topic. Research and research-led practice helped in the emergence of the market. But as somebody who's been involved in this, and I'm asking questions where I'm putting my hand up in terms of answering them and saying guilty as charged as much as anyone else, where's the new research coming from that challenges the existing market? We've seen, for example, the emergence of crowdfunding, and particularly equity crowdfunding as a new development. Where are the critics of that? Who's asking the difficult questions about how that works, whether it should work, can work, what the constraints are, what the opportunities are, what the upsides are, what the downsides are? We don't have that. What strikes me as somebody who's been working in this area is that effective new insight is more likely now to come from the practitioner community than it is from the academic community. 30 years ago, the first research study we did on business angels was funded by ESRC. It didn't have a theoretical base. It didn't have methodological sophistication. It didn't have methodological innovation. It just had a question that needed an answer. That research would not be funded today. It doesn't meet the canons of what's deemed to be acceptable, fundable academic research. Should we re-examine the nature of what we do in terms of the structure of the academy and the funding of our activities? What about a second application? Entrepreneurship education. And actually, this is more a reflection on management education in general than entrepreneurship education in particular. This starts with a number of questions. And again, these are questions to which I don't necessarily have any automatic or immediate answer, but is it possible to fundamentally criticize the society in which we live? These are questions I think we in the academy need to ask ourselves. It's what I describe as the goldfish problem. You know the line, if you want to know about water, don't ask a goldfish. Because it's immersed in it, it's the taken for granted world it exists in. It's not self-critical and self-reflective about that. We ask a question, are academics the salaried employees of state or private universities marked by the very habits of thinking which need to be criticized? That's the patronage problem. And patronage has always been a problem for the university. The provision of resources creates space for creative thinking, but it also provides obligations to the interest that provide the patronage. Whether that's the medieval monastic tradition, where universities, as in the founding charter of Clare College, Cambridge, identified it as existing to provide and educate clerks for the king's service. The provision of powerful interest groups has been something that has driven the academy for a long time. And I'll come back to that briefly. And we have a question about academic fundamentalism and epistemic drift. What's the balance and how do we manage the balance between a commitment to research, the generation of new knowledge? Is that the sole function of the university? If it is, we're in the camp of academic fundamentalism. What happens, however, if we go over to the dark side, we go over to the world of practice, we see the agenda for our research and engagement being driven by the needs of practitioners? Does that compromise the fundamental research that we do? Does it lead to a process of epistemic drift where we lose control of the agenda, where we lose sense of identity? And these, I think, are very real problems and challenges that we're identifying with and seeking to address. But they're not new. Anybody in the business school world or as a reflective practitioner observing the world we live in who's interested in impact and engagement, the development of our research and the development of our pedagogy, I think we'd do well to go back and read Robert Lynn's interesting little essay published back in 1939, Knowledge for What? And Lynn, among other things, talks about the role of science in society. University professors who carry forward social science as part of culture, these professors are hired by businessmen trustees, and their commitment to the status quo is great. There is a tension between what we do in terms of the radical divergent thinking that is expected of us and what may be growingly insistent demands that this thinking shall not be subversive. And I'll come back in a moment and talk about one particular example of that. But there is a tension there, which I think in the business school we face, and I don't think we've resolved. The problem from an education point of view is that much of what we do, not just in business schools, but more widely across the academy, is relentlessly performative. It's about task orientation, skill acquisition and development. It's about learning to do what we do. It's about knowledge transfer, transferring, lifting parcels from one domain to another. It's a bit like the old description of a PhD as the art of transferring bones from one graveyard to another. It's a laborious task, but one that does not necessarily have any purpose. It is a bit, in other words, this performative nature of education. It's a bit like chickens picking up corn. It's a repetitive process which is necessary but not necessarily enlightening. And it's a long way from what we might see as the Arnoldian 19th century belief in education as the critical questioning of knowledge. So rather than this chicken picking up corn mentality, how should we look at and how should we do education in a business school environment, whether that's undergraduate education, postgraduate education, or executive education? Well, again, to go back to a couple of old friends, and apologies for quoting John Stuart Mill. This comes from an address that Mill gave to an institution some miles up the road. That's St. Andrews, I believe, has a university institution associated with it. And Stuart Mill, in a commencement address in 1867 at St. Andrews, speaking as a non-graduate of any university, talked about what professional men should carry away with them from a university. It's not professional knowledge, but that which should direct the use of their professional knowledge. In other words, education is not about the transfer of one packet of knowledge from one person to another. It's about the meta process of understanding how you learn what you learn. Alfred North Whitehead, writing and in part reflecting on the formation of Harvard Business School, made a somewhat similar comment. The business of the future requires a different type of man, an aptitude for eliciting generalizations from particulars, for seeing the diverse illustration of generalities in diverse circumstances. It is the survey of society from generalities. So the question is, if we take a John Stuart Mill or a Whitehead approach, and what we're transferring, what we're developing is not professional knowledge, but that which should direct the use of professional knowledge, what would that look like? How would our curriculum change? How would we do what we do? It begins to change the nature of the pedagogy. In a piece written a number of years back, Pat Leather talked about the storytelling, the telling tales dimension to education and pedagogy. And much of what we do, certainly in entrepreneurship education, historically and up to this point, has been grounded in the telling of realist tales, the empirical world as it is, looking at war stories, reifying and transmitting reality, without necessarily engaging in a critical, reflective approach to challenge that knowledge. Now that pattern is beginning to change. It's changing, I think, more rapidly in other parts of higher education than it is changing in the business school environment. But it's important that we begin to think about these issues, to challenge what we do, and to challenge how we do it internally. Because as Latham put it, our pedagogy becomes a site not for working through more effective transformation strategies. It's not the knowledge transfer process. It's about analyzing the discourses available to us, what we're invested in, what we invest, how we do what we do. It's about stepping back from the day to day. What we do, and jazz does come into it. I don't think I've got a fly fishing illustration, but I'm sure we could find one. Jazz does come into it, because what we're doing in terms of our pedagogy, our approach to teaching, whether it's entrepreneurship education or working with executives, is to see a shift in focus from knowledge as a stored artifact to seeing knowledge as a constructed capability in action. It's the ability to do. Learning, in other words, is not a matter of what one knows, but who one becomes. It's not about knowledge, it's about wisdom. To go back to an earlier point. This comes from a wonderful essay on how to teach free jazz in the classroom. which is all those of you who are familiar with Ornette Coleman and everything that followed will appreciate the difficulty of teaching the unphrased, the unstructured, the improvisational in terms of traditional form. But to go back to Robert Lynn's knowledge for what essay, research and education without an actively selective point of view, without this point perspective of the critic of institutions, as he put it in what I think is a memorable phrase, becomes the ditty bag of an idiot, filled with bits of pebbles, straws, feathers, and other random hoardings. And for those of you who are interested, the illustration was the official university photograph taken on the day I demitted office as dean, showing the consequences of 6 years in the role, from which I'm still in recovery. So that's something to look forward to in. To pick this up again in terms of a third domain, what do we know about academic entrepreneurship? This has been what, excuse me, one of the preeminent areas of debate and discourse that we've experienced in recent years. Summarized memorably as the idea plus money equals success formula. And if it was that easy, I wouldn't be standing here talking to you about it. I'd be fly fishing in much warmer climes as a permanent occupation. But this is part of a discourse we've seen over the last 20 years about the marketization of higher education. The Slaughter and Leslie's wonderful book in the mid-1980s, Universities for Sale, raised the issue of what was going on in universities as the commercialization agenda became more important, as the nature of the curricula changed to meet the needs and expectations, for example, of employer groups. We've seen in the UK and more widely afield the third mission rhetoric, adding engagement, commercialization as part of a wider university mission in addition to research and teaching. And there is an argument, and has been an argument for a long time, that university spin-out companies in particular are important. And this is something where I and colleagues have spent some time looking at the phenomenon, not least from the financing point of view. The view that academic research, and particularly university research generated in intellectual property, can be and should be exploited, not least because there is an economic development role. Spin-out companies tend to start close to the universities where the IP was generated. They tend to employ well-qualified graduates that has widely seen to have an economic development contribution. That leads to public policy interest. For many years, Scottish Enterprise, among many regional development agencies, has set targets for the number of university spin-out companies to be created. But is that a good thing? Is what we're doing right and appropriate? Does it work? Richard Lambert, who at the time he wrote this was, I think, DG of the Confederation of British Industry and former editor of the Financial Times, did a report on university-industry interaction, published by 2004. And he essentially argues that it is the responsibility of university, of government, of business, to seek closer engagement, to seek more opportunities for the exploitation, the commercialization of university research. But at the same time, or very similar, Jonathan Guthrie, writing in the Financial Times, asked a question that no academic researcher at the time was asking. And that was about growing doubts on the efficacy of university spin-outs. And Guthrie argued that there were no figures to demonstrate that the costs were less than the benefits. There was a need for better measurement of returns. Questioned whether spin-outs were actually creating value and described the debate as falling back on the voodoo of anecdotal evidence. So what is the case? University research on commercialization is almost entirely dominated by the university spin-out company process. And yet, spin-out companies and the exploitation of IP more generally generates no more than about 3% of university income from commercialization activities, from business interaction. it's not the most important line of business. So why do we study it? I don't know. Look at the efficacy issue. Most spin-outs start small and stay small. 3 years after startup, the average size of a university spin-out company is still under 10 employees and under 500,000 a year in sales. Now, that's saying that one acknowledges that the exploitation of novel technology is very often on a longer time cycle than that. That's just a snapshot, but that's where the official statistics come from. What's interesting is that if you separate out university spin-out companies where the university retains an equity ownership interest in the IP, the performance is significantly less. Now, on the face of it, universities ought to know better what's going on with their research. The evidence is, and it's not trivial, if the average spin-out has 9 employees, the spin-outs measured in the same way without ongoing university involvement in the ownership of IP, but that are based on the exploitation of university IP, employ on average about 70 people. After 3 years, we are not talking about a trivial difference. So what's going on? Why are universities seeking to benefit from, because it's not a major income generator. I suspect it's still the case, and for those of you who heard my last inaugural lecture, you'll realize that this comment was made then as well. I think it is still the case that the combined expenditure on supporting the spin-out company process exceeds the benefits generated by those spin-outs. There are, of course, exceptions. There are companies that have spun out based on university research that have done very well, but they are exceptions. But we have an entire tradition of research and a phalanx of public policy predicated on the exception as the norm. And yet, almost no academic research has fundamentally looked at the data, raised the questions, and asked, how can we, should we, could we do it better? And the biggest growth area in terms of company formation from the universities is graduate enterprise. The average employment after 3 years in a graduate formed company, which is not based on the exploitation of the university IP, and acknowledging that the data are incredibly difficult to get systematically, the average employment is just over 1, including the founder. So we're seeing the creation of a phalanx of self-employed individuals trading under a corporate banner, rather than the stimulus to the emergence of the new white heat of technological revolution. And yet we don't have a debate about this. And I wonder why. And maybe it's because we're more concerned as academics about the contribution of the minimum publishable unit in the salami-sliced approach to our research, which doesn't engage with the fundamental issues, which isn't predicated on the pursuit of wisdom, which is fundamentally about, or is not fundamentally about, the critic of institutions. What we have, in essence, is a phenomenon where the rhetoric of aspiration has overtaken the reality of achievement. And once the bandwagon, in terms of research, has got underway, it becomes very difficult to step off. It becomes very difficult to raise these issues. And some of us, and one or two of those in the room will be familiar with this and have heard me extemporizing at length on it. What we have, to go back to an earlier analogy, is essentially a process of voodoo when we look at this in terms of research. So the cultural anthropologist Bartowski talks about voodoo as the melange of superstitious beliefs used for deceptive purposes, which seems a reasonably good description of many of the research papers that I've read on this topic. Deirdre McCloskey talked about voodoo as a religion that is impotent, innocuous, and ineffectual. The magic is repetitious, and magic has to be repetitious or it doesn't work. And as Eric Maus said, magicians will take refuge behind questions of procedures and technicalities. Because, of course, if magical prowess doesn't work, it's not because the magic is flawed, it's because the circumstances were against us. There was something that got in the way. And guess what? When you talk about the development and success or otherwise of academic spin-out companies, it's always because the environment is against us. The technology wasn't quite right. We missed the launch window. We didn't get the market right. It's always somebody else's problem. It's not that the average spin-out company in the UK is based on 3 awarded patents. The equivalent in the US is based on 43. The intellectual property platforms, the constitution in terms of non-equity funding in the US is 5 times as high as it is in the UK in terms of funding per company. There are fundamental things in terms of the structure and mechanism of what we're doing. But the big question, if you like, the elephant in the room in this topic area, is what universities are doing in terms of the exploitation of technology. It's not the university's job. It's not the core expertise. Why do universities insist on retaining ownership of IP when the data suggests that that is detrimental to the performance of the company? In some survey work we did with university spin-outs and would-be spin-outs, excuse me, a number of years ago, we asked what the biggest barrier to raising finance was. And the involvement of the ongoing involvement of the university in the business came out as number one. But universities persist in the belief that exploiting IP through this mechanism is justifiable, defensible, and supportable. The research evidence is it doesn't work. So why do we do it? That's where I think we need a critic of institutions in terms of the articulation and demonstration of these arguments. And what, finally, about a fourth domain of application? And you'll be pleased to know I'm not going to talk about this at length. But it takes us back to the discourse of crisis. Over the last decade, we've become familiar with names like Barings, long-term capital management, the schadenfreude of seeing 2 Nobel Prize winners work encapsulated in a business that went so spectacularly belly up is an interesting one. Lehman Brothers, RBS, etc. All of these, when we look at failure, and I don't want to go into unpacking the ideology of the development and the collapse of any of these individual institutions, all of them pose the question for me, where is the capacity for exercising vision? Where was the prudence in passing judgment? What was going on when we looked at these things? And some of that is about the creation of arbitrage around selective access to information, the non-availability or universal ability of information created opportunities for the exercise of judgment and discretion in ways which was not necessarily in the interest of the social good. It was, as Jim March referred to it a number of years ago, a consequence of what he called consequentialist theology. That is the instrumental, rational focus on the achievement of personal gain, self-interest above social interest. And we're only beginning to see the discourse of that, the critical discourse emerging. Some of that comes from commentators outside the business community. The vampire squid, for those of you who remember the arcane journalistic descriptions of the global financial crisis, will appreciate that I think it might have been a New Yorker article described Goldman Sachs as a vampire squid hoovering up and destroying everything that lay in its path, which I thought was an unkind slur on the reputation of the vampire squid as one of the more interesting marine animals. But David McNally, in his social history of the crisis, makes the point that the crisis was not just a minor problem of analysis and perspective and decision making on the part of a small number of individuals in a small number of institutions. His suggestion is, and again he uses the metaphor of voodoo in articulating this, his argument is that the crisis was systemic, endemic, and embedded in the nature of the system. It was there to happen because it represented a mindset, a way of thinking, which was rationalist and calculative in its orientation, rather than taking a more wisdom-oriented, judgmental approach. The response, of course, to that crisis has been many and varied. For some, the response has been crisis. What crisis? And I'm thinking here of the academic commentary on the evolution of the crisis over the last 5 years, not necessarily what the practitioners have made of it. So it's kind of an I'm all right, Jack mentality. Things aren't so bad for me. Never mind that I'm sitting in my deck chair in a wasteland. For others, the response is opportunistic. I'm sorry this doesn't come out terribly well, but the caption is, "And so, while the end of the world scenario will be rife with unimaginable horrors, we believe that the pre-end period will be filled with unprecedented opportunities for profit." Now, I've read that or something similar to it in a significant number of business plans. The other response is, of course, the promise that we'll do better. And I think we all can identify with this conversation. We've certainly seen a variant of this in many of the reflections on reports on corporate governance practice, reforms or non-reforms after the crisis. It's kind of, look, I can't promise I'll change, but I can promise I'll pretend to change. My question is, where do we stand as an academy in addressing these issues? How do we begin to think our way through these? How do we come to some sort of a conclusion? And I should have a fly rod in my hand there. I really should. Somebody said, I think it may have been at a workshop we had here last week, you can never go wrong with an Einstein quote. But I actually like Lewis Carroll a lot better. I've gone mad. I'm afraid so. You're entirely bonkers. But I'll tell you the secret. All the best people are. There is an element of being controversial, having to be controversial in terms of what we do and how we do it as we move forward in addressing some of these issues. There is, I think, a need for an awareness of Einstein's point that old ways of thinking won't help us solve new problems, and doing what we've always done won't help us come up with new answers. To go back to information, knowledge, and wisdom, and to pick up, Gavin, on your advanced simplicity or simple complexity or informed bewilderment idea, less is more. We've been very good historically at managing the transition from information to knowledge, building the connections, understanding the relationships. What we need, I think, moving forward is to understand and be able to separate out what is really significant from everything else. I know that much of what I've done over the last 3 decades or so has been focused on the middle of those boxes. And I think I and my colleagues have become very good at establishing those connections and relationships, but not necessarily in focusing, as a wisdom perspective would have it, on what's important. And the challenge for me, I think the challenge for all of us, is how we make that shift and what we do with it and how we turn it into practice. It means, I think, that we should become critics of institutions. Ian talked about leadership and the leadership initiative in the school, which is part of the reason that I'm back here, a very significant part of it. But when I think about leadership, when I think about its role in learning, when I think about how it plays out in terms of how we think about life, the associations that I make with that are not the associations of the technical background of the university. They're not the business school connections. One of the reasons I think the business school exists and should exist within the context of a university is it allows us to make connections with a much wider set of intellectual traditions. The reference points this evening have been philosophy, sociology, history, poetry, much more than conventional discipline-specific references. And that's entirely deliberate, because that's where I think wisdom will lie. Those are the connections that I see around leadership. It is about connections with philosophy, with thinkers outside the narrow confines of the business disciplines. And I think in the university context, we have a real, but as yet unexploited or virtually unexploited opportunity to build connections with those wider range of disciplines, to become genuinely informed critics of institutions. A conclusion, which isn't a conclusion, from Corson's Inlet. I think it says it better than I can. So, thank you very much.
Thank you very much for a wonderful and insightful presentation. I have one issue, really. When you say producing more knowledge than we need, does that apply to fly fishing, I was thinking. In my case, you know, there is not enough knowledge for my needs in fly fishing, but it also reminds me that the real pleasure of fly fishing is a philosophy and the reflection rather than the getting the end result of maximizing your fish performance, you know, so fish catching performance. So what this gets me thinking, you know, is the role of critical reflection, which is a theme throughout your talk. And we talked today in the meeting of the school on research power as being one of the primary indicators of the REF, current REF. How do we get critical reflection to actually be measured and actually become part of the research assessment process? And what does that say for our institution of measuring research? Thank you.
The fly fishing question is a lot easier to answer than the research impact one. Let me address the fly fishing point. Can you have too much knowledge? Yes, you can. You can have an enormous amount of knowledge. I think a practical art like fly fishing or any of the things I've been talking about, which I think if you take Aristotle's description of phronesis, what we are dealing with is engagement in practical arts, is the wisdom to know what you don't know and the wisdom to selectively know what you need to know. And that goes beyond just the accumulation of knowledge. I think for many of us, the accumulation of knowledge gets in the way of wise reflection on what is actually is essential. On the REF question, the revolutionary in me would say, take the exercise and burn it. The pragmatist in me would say, it's the rationalist calculative world we live in and we need to find a way of playing that game that allows us to do what we do. The reason I can stand up here and say what I'm saying and spend time thinking in this way is because I know I don't have to publish this in a 4-star journal. I wouldn't have done this 30 years ago because that may not have been seen as career enhancing. I can afford to do it now because I'm at the summit rather than at the base camp. And I think we play those political games. I think it is a both-and exercise. We're all of us pragmatists, or we ought to be. I think the challenge is, if you see the REF process, the assessment process, as another form of patronage that sits upon the university system, we're encouraged to play the game and rather than challenge the rules, understand the rules better rather than challenge the rules at all. And I do think there's a challenge. I don't have an easy answer for it. And the answer I would give you, reflecting on where you and I are, is a different answer to in terms of priorities and activities than the answer I would give to the 30-year-old postdoctoral fellow who's still seeking to make their way in this academic world.
Richard, very, very interesting talk. Thanks very much. I guess I've been misled, but I'm an engineer. And I know how engineers work, and I know how academic engineers work. So, you know, a chemical engineer works on things that are of value to the chemical industry, and civil engineers work on how to build bridges and so forth. Yeah. And I thought business schools were there to work out how to build businesses. But you don't seem to have said that. In fact, if you look at the way some of the more prominent business school outputs recently, they've been cheerleaders for some of the worst business practices that have happened and haven't really poked and prodded and given insights that lead. So am I wrong here? I mean, should my approach would be more engineering approached than philosophically approached with the business school's relation to the wider range of business. Is that wrong?
No, I think there's a fundamental point there. Mind you, I mean, having talked to some of my engineering colleagues in the past, I'm not sure that I necessarily allow the products of some of our engineering schools near the construction of railroads and bridges necessary. I think there is an issue that we have kind of disappeared up our own fundament in some of this. I don't think necessarily that the quote-unquote building better businesses is the be-all and end-all of what we do and what we should do in a business school. But I think we've engaged in a form of arcane scholarship that is more to do with satisfying the sorts of issues that Peter raised in terms of research assessment exercises, the publishing of work because it's important to publish rather than the publishing of work because it might make a difference. Whether, you know, I go back to the figures on citations. If less than a third of what we're writing in the social sciences is being cited by other scholars, why on earth would it be read and would influence the practice? And I think there's a major disjoint there, which we have to fundamentally address. I would go back to John Stuart Mill, and he said, and he was talking about the development of professional schools of knowledge, trade schools as he non-pejoratively referred to them, like law, and medicine and engineering and the, as he called it, the industrial arts. His illustration was, you don't create a better, and this is his injunction to universities, you don't create a better shoemaker by teaching them how to make shoes. You teach them why to make shoes. You teach them the values. I don't think we've taught in business schools the values of why we do business. And that's why we see the sanctification of Enron, the same month that Enron went belly up, there was a piece in one of the leading academic journals extolling Enron as the embodiment of all that was good about business school education. It was the largest employer of MBA graduates outside the consulting sector in the US. There was no sense of critical reflection. There was no sense of value. And that's why I think a shift from a focus on knowledge to a focus on wisdom is warranted. It's to allow us to get back to a point where we can have the conversations, we can produce the sort of knowledge and insight that you're talking about.
In a way, I wanted to kind of link together these first two questions. So just to introduce myself, my name's Duncan, I'm a PhD candidate here in the school. I found your introduction really, really brutal and dispassionate. And honestly, at this time in the day, maybe I would have enjoyed a positivist fairy tale a little bit more. But I thought it was interesting to think about your example about spin-outs. You know, universities not only in Britain, all over around the world, put a huge amount of effort into trying to help entrepreneurs. And I think it's completely credible that the most effective thing they could do is get out of the way, because maybe they're just not very well placed to do that. But I think it's interesting to think about this disconnect between something like the REF and practice. And on the one hand, what can critical insight do? Because I think that in a way there's a very positivist fantasy that you can have simple prescriptions about what businesses need to do and you follow them and they work in a straightforward way. And there's a lot of just fantasy there. There's a lot of management advice which simply doesn't work, and a lot of the heuristics that we have fall down in the real world. But then the flip side is that a lot of the critical insight that we have, actually we don't try to marshal it to use it as a lever to change practice. And partly that is because academic research is focused on extending knowledge and practice is often based on trying to work out what we know works. But I wonder, why do you think it is that this critical insight hasn't been mobilized enough, hasn't been turned into a tool to shape reality enough? Just a simple question.
Yeah. How long have I got? Why is critical insight? Critical insight is not as common a commodity as you might be implying. I think to use a phrase from Elliot Jacks, we've been very good at inventing illusions to reality. But actually what lies behind that is perhaps of less substance. Well, you made reference to the spin-out example. You don't have to look very long at the evidence to raise the sorts of issues that I've raised. And yet there are 1,000+ academic papers extolling the university spin-out formation process as the way to do it. Now that's getting to the point where it's not wisdom, it's not knowledge. It is, in Deirdre McCloskey's terms, voodoo. It's the belief in something magical. And if we continue to believe it, and if the circumstances are right, the magic will work. Well, the evidence suggests the magic doesn't work, cannot work. It's fundamentally, constitutively out of kilter. But the reward systems do not reward the negative, do not reward the publication of the non-finding. You know, there is an academic natural selection process which favours positive results. And as anybody who's tried to publish a paper which argues that the results are negative, which demonstrates, in essence, the null hypothesis is supported, will have enormous difficulty. So we've got a right censoring bias in terms of everything that we see written and published. But I don't think the critical reflection is either as critical or as reflective, or indeed as common as you might be implying. And I think that's where we need to start. It's what we do and how we construct an academic system and a reward and value system that allows us to do that.
Richard, I suppose I'm sitting here as a representative of what you referred to as the dark side. Though I'm honored to visit occasionally and come to the light and hopefully spread a little light. But out here on the dark side, one of our mantras in running businesses, the practitioner doing it for real, is what you measure is what you get. Mm. So it's easy to measure research in the research assessment exercise. What thoughts do you have on how you might measure wisdom in order to promote the creation of wisdom?
Probably start with an observation that that's almost an oxymoron in terms of the belief in measurement as such is part of the rationalist calculative mindset that has created the sorts of difficulties we have. I think what I'm thinking about is a shift in value systems and the need to measure in that way as the be all and end all within the context of what we do in the academy is part of the problem. So I don't think it's about designing better measurement systems. I think it's about designing and developing a value system where measurement is not the be all and end all. That's not to deny the importance of understanding that, but I would have the same argument with you about the design of financial reporting systems, the same discussion about how companies represent themselves in their accounts, what goes into and what shouldn't go into a business plan and how that's constituted. I think we could have the same conversation. It's not about measurement, it's about representation.
Richard, thanks for the talk. Somebody said that this is a brutal speech, I suppose, a presentation. I guess it's a brutally honest presentation. My question is to do with one point you raised on the problem of being a critic of institutions, that is the patronage problem. Is it possible to be, are you referring to be a critic, are you referring to be a constructive critic helping the institutions? Or are you suggesting to go perhaps even further to be, to a certain degree, somebody might say it's a subversive critic? I think that's quite a negative term. Because I was thinking, listening to your talk, I was thinking, your talk would go down very well among perhaps intellectuals in China, because I know you and Professor Clark were in China recently. I think they would love to hear you telling them that they can be, they should be the critics of institutions, social critics probably, okay? But I think they face tremendous problems, especially this patronage problem. Is it possible to overcome the patronage problem, or is it really just possible to go as far as to be a constructive critic? Thank you.
My heart says, yes, of course, this is about being subversive. My head says an awful lot of it is about being constructive. And there is a difference in terms of role, and this partly goes back to Gavin's prior question. It's the distinction, if you like, between a theologian and a martyr. A theologian understands martyrdom, but only a martyr feels the fire. And universities are full of theologians with very few martyrs.
Thank you very much, Richard. I hope I leave here an older and wiser man tonight. That will be for others to judge.
Certainly, like me, it'll be older.
You should have been pitted against the speakers at University of Scotland event at Holyrood last night. There might be some people in the audience there when they're talking about commercialization of the science space in the context of spin-outs and so on. And the big issues that came up from all the keynote speakers were A, access to capital, the lack of it, and B, outstanding business leadership, or the lack of it. I relate absolutely to what you're saying, and looking at this evening and looking at your examples, Anderson's had a business unit about boardroom ethics, which they canned shortly before the demise of Enron because they couldn't make money out of it. Anybody that's read Shredded, which about the demise of the Royal Bank, will know that there was mountains of technical knowledge in around that boardroom table, but no wisdom whatsoever. Mm. Lehman Brothers was propped up by an accountancy trick called Repo 105 for about 6 years before. It was actually bankrupt for about 6 years before they pulled it, and so on. So if outstanding business leadership is the issue, what is it you can do to take the big theme from tonight, which is understanding the difference between knowledge and wisdom, and turning that into something you can teach here to give us out in the dark side, or that's what Gavin called it, the business leaders that we need to make our businesses do better?
It's a very good question, Sandy. There's some people you should never let into an audience because they ask the really difficult questions, and I think that's an example. Part of me would say, yeah, I mean, there are all sorts of wonderful things we can do in terms of the teaching of leadership. I think that we're looking at that and examining it. I do have an issue, and in the sense I don't have an answer off stock in terms of the answer to the question. There is almost a contradiction, implicit and fundamental, in talking about teaching wisdom. It's a bit like forcing yourself to relax. It seems to be two contrary pressures at one. And I think what we're struggling, not just here in terms of what we do with our curricula, but more widely, I think we're just beginning to engage with the question of what would it mean to put wisdom rather than knowledge at the center of what we do? What are the implications for the design of the curriculum? What are the implications for our expectations of students? What are our expectations of what we teach and how we teach it? I think we're beginning to engage with those issues. I don't think we're yet at the point where we've reached a conclusion, but I think it's something that we need to pay much more attention to. We need to work much more aggressively at. So, you know, the next time I do one of these lectures, because I seem to do inaugural lectures at the frequency of about one every 5 years or something. So,
is that a warning?
It's a promise. So I don't have an off the stock answer, Sandy, for that one, but I think that is where the big challenge for business schools in the 21st century is to engage with those issues and begin to provide that. Because I think if we fail to address that challenge, we as business schools will fail to offer the sort of leadership that the world of practice expects of us.
Perhaps rather simplistic observations. The first one is that most people who are critical of institutions usually end up being fired. They're the whistleblower. I have knowledge of a friend of mine who employed by a local university, and that happened to them. So I think it's very difficult to do what you're talking about. I think of the United Nations that seems to, you know, have no teeth ever, or very, very rarely. And the same sort of thing, lots of talk, lots of criticism, but no action. And there's always a fall guy. The second thing I would say is that I did a master's in European law, and what I found out was it was funded by European money, which suited me, but deep down I found that the professors were writing books. I'm not talking about Edinburgh, but I'm sure this is happening throughout the UK, because they were funded by European money. Everything was funded by European money, and I would have called that, deep down, propaganda. So I didn't really approve, but it's a great big machine that can't be stopped. Do you have any observations on these, my thoughts?
I agree with both of the points you're making. I mean, in saying that we should become critics of institutions, I'm not underplaying the difficulty of doing that, both in terms of finding a standpoint from which to effectively criticize, because that in itself is difficult, but also recognizing the challenges that come from being a critic of institutions. Your European funding example is, to use a technical academic term, is the gravy train we all benefit from. It drives what we do. We pattern our activities to suit the sources of funding available. It's the 21st century form of patronage. It used to be the Medici family. In the mid-19th century, when all the red bricks were established, look at the founding charters of the Birminghams, the Liverpools, the Manchesters of this world. It is rife with references to the interests of the industrial class, the creation of repositories of essentially teaching expertise, not research expertise, that would provide the educated workforce that was necessary to man the factories. It was an instrumental engagement. Universities throughout history have been parties to whatever the power interests have been at the time. For us now, it's research funding. So our research questions are, that's why I make the point. The shift in research funding would not allow me to do now what I did 30 years ago, looking at the early stage risk capital market. Because what I was doing then, what I would do now, doesn't fit the rubric of where the funding is available. Now, I'm in the position where I can afford to step outside that, step off that particular travel letter. But many of my colleagues are not in the position where they can do that. We still live in a world dominated by patronage, and that, I think, is a fundamental issue in terms of the constitution and operation of the university sector as a whole, not just the business school. That's a really cheerful note to end on. I'm sorry about that.